We had a chance to talk to Dr. Russell Blaylock, MD, a retired neurosurgeon and author. His trailblazing research has tirelessly documented the fact that there is an epidemic of neurological disorders in the Western world directly tied to toxins in our environment. And the story behind the story concerning the larger global eugenics program behind population reduction.
I'm Dr. Russell Blaylock. I'm a board certified neurosurgeon. I've retired from active practice. Now I do primarily theoretical research in neurosciences and spend most of my time writing research articles, review articles on neuroscience projects at the present time. What I found interesting in all of this when I first started looking at it, looking at the funding by the Rockefeller Foundation and many of the other foundations like Ford Foundation, the Carnegie Foundation, and looking back into the history of it, and I came accidentally upon a book by Dr. Lily Kay. She was doing a research project looking at the origins of molecular biology in the United States. And that was primarily my interest, was just reviewing the history of molecular biology. But to my surprise, much of the book describes the what was called the Science of Man Project by the Rockefeller Foundation. And primarily, and this is in a period about 1910, primarily what he was interested in and his foundation board was doing social engineering. They were concerned that society was made of a lot of people they considered undesirables. Their definition of undesirables was people that had lower IQ, people that had physical defects, people who had diseases, people who did not behave in a way that these group of elitists thought people should behave in a society. So their idea was to use eugenics, which was the primary science at the time, to redevelop man, to create a new type of person. And they coined the term social engineering. Now, of course, at that time, we didn't have DNA as a concept. So they were using rather crude genetics to bring this about in the very beginning. So what she shows is the Rockefeller Foundation was really putting a lot of money in this. And in order to do that, he thought, what I'll do is I will fund major universities. And he picked Caltech as one of those universities, and then some in the East, like Harvard and Johns Hopkins and Columbia, University of Chicago, as the primary centers where this type of study would be carried out in how to re-engineer human beings to be in the form that they thought humans should be. And gradually, as science began to become more sophisticated and eugenics began to get a really bad name as the period of Adolf Hitler occurred, and you realize that the Rockefeller eugenists, before Hitler became well-known in power, they were traveling to Germany and exchanging information on these eugenic programs. So a fair amount of this information came from the Rockefeller Foundation. Of course, after World War II, when the world found out a lot of what was going on in eugenics and the horror of eugenics, most of these programs were abandoned, and the Rockefeller Foundations very quickly said to all their members, let's never use the name eugenics anymore. What we'll talk about is social engineering, the new science of man, behavioralism. So they had these key words that meant basically the same type idea, that is redesigning man and man's behavior and controlling it through elitist ideas. But we would do it through new science, and we would establish major institutions in the United States that would control medical education, through his General Education Board, which was a very powerful foundation regulation of education in America. And so he would appoint professors that would be directors of these programs. He groomed people who believed, like he did, that in fact man should be redesigned. We need this science of man to re-engineer human beings. but do it in a more scientific way than this crude eugenics program that he began with. And what that necessitated was using what was called molecular biology. Well, with the discovery of DNA, this became more sophisticated in that you could manipulate certain genes and change how the brain functioned. And of course, then they got into the neuroscience field itself and began to look at, well, how does the brain work? How can we change behavior by altering brain function? And this has led up to the present day when we have things like the decade of the brain, where there's intense study of the behavioral functions of the brain and how it works. But if you look through her book where she talks about the actual funding, their actual ideas, it's the same theme that started back in 1910. That is, we're going to recreate man in our image, what we think man should be, how people should think, what they should think, the limitations on their behavior. It's a true scientific social engineering of human beings. Well, leading from that, when we start looking at, well, look at some of the programs that have sort of spurred out of this, you know, the high-tech DNA manipulation, brain manipulation through electrodes or through transmission outside of electrodes to change human thinking. These are the more sophisticated programs that are a little bit more obvious, but then there's things that are less obvious. For instance, fluoridating water. We look at the original justification for fluoridating water back in 1945 when they picked a couple of cities, Grand Rapids, Michigan and Muskegon. Grand Rapids was going to be fluoridated, Muskegon was not, and they were going to compare and use the idea that fluoride was preventing cavities. So even before the study had been completed, they announced that it was a grand success and that fluoridated water produced a 30 to 60% reduction in cavities. What they didn't say was that in the unfluoridated city, there was a very similar drop in the incidence of cavities as well. And in fact, throughout the entire world, we began to see in the developed world a tremendous fall in the incidence of dental cavities. That had nothing to do with fluoride. What it had to do with was increased intake of calcium, mainly through cheese consumption, and better diets, better oral hygiene. And a number of studies proved that, one of which was conducted by the U.S. Public Health Service. It was one of the largest American studies at the time. They looked at 39,000 school children, in which they looked at the effect of fluoridation versus non-fluoridation, and they found it had no beneficial effect at all. Well, they hid that document so scientists couldn't examine it and the public and the media would never see it. Well, a Dr. Yamanyanis, who was a chemist, filed a Freedom of Information lawsuit, had it released, and then he saw why they wanted to hide it, and that's because it clearly demonstrated fluoride did not reduce cavities. Since that time, there's been a number of studies, one of which included eight countries, another which included all studies on fluoride, independent studies on fluoride and dental caries for the past 30 years. Another study included 400,000 children in India. All of these studies showed the same thing. Adding fluoride to water did not reduce cavities at all. And in fact, several of the studies, it showed it increased cavities. And it did so because it weakened the dental layer of the tooth and made it more prone to become cavities. So now that we've established, and it's admitted by the National Science Foundation study, which was recently completed, that fluoridating water does not reduce cavities. There's no modern evidence whatsoever that fluoridating water reduces cavities at all. So you have to ask the question, well, why are you still fluoridating water? Now, European countries have caught on very quickly. None of them fluoridate their water. Britain fluoridates about 60% of its water, and it forced fluoridation on Ireland. But the mainland European countries do not fluoridate water, do not allow it. But the United States, we still have the federal government and in collusion with the American Dental Association going to various cities, even small cities, using their pressure, their money, taxpayer money, to try to force local city councils to fluoridate the water. In the state of California, in fact, they've ordered the fluoridation of all waters in every city and village over 10,000 inhabitants, whether they vote to not fluoridate their water or not. So you have to ask the question, well, now that scientifically we've proven that fluoridating water has no effect on reducing cavities, why is the federal government spending so much money and effort to force fluoridation of the rest of the water supply, and even insisting that bottled water be fluoridated, that no one would have access to unfluoridated water except the elite? Well, if we look at the scientific studies on what is the effect of fluoridation, well, we know fluoridating water through a number of studies, some of which were ordered by the federal government itself in the earlier days, increases cancer risk. Burke and Yamanyanis, two scientists, did one of the largest cancer studies in relationship to fluoridating water supply. They looked at all cities, 10 cities in the eastern part of the United States, and they showed that in fluoridated cities as compared to unfluoridated, there was a 10% increase in cancer. This was a criticized study, so they repeated it, and they did all cities east of the Mississippi, above 10,000 population, comparing fluoridated and unfluoridated. Now, what they did, they compared the cancer statistics before fluoridation and then 13 to 17 years after fluoridation. Again, they found there was a 10% increase cancer death incidence in the cities that had been fluoridated. Now, when you say cancer death, and that means people who died of cancer, you can appreciate there can be a lot more people who developed cancer who didn't die. So the actual cancer incidence is much higher. This study was so impressive to some members of Congress, they ordered a study of this link to cancer through the Battelle Research Institute. These studies showed that, number one, it produced a number of types of cancer, one which was a very rare liver cancer, and it significantly increased the growth of cancer in people who already had cancers. Well, despite these studies, they're still fluoridating water. They found out it increased fractures, not only in the elderly, but in younger women. And it increased hip fractures in older men to a greater extent than the women. Well, a hip fracture in someone over 65 has a high mortality rate. So it's a good way, if you wanted to increase the mortality of the elderly and get them out of the way, which is in discussion today. We know that it has profound effects on the brain. One of the most impressive was done by Dr. Phyllis Mullenix, who was a highly regarded neurotoxicologist, someone who studies the toxicity of different elements on the brain. Well, she was drafted into doing this when she worked for the Forsyth Dental Research Institute. And she had never worked with fluoride, didn't know a lot about it. Now, I know this firsthand because I've interviewed her and talked with her, and I know her. And she said when she first was going to do the research project to see if fluoridating water had any effect on the brain's function, she thought it would be negative. She didn't think fluoride would have any adverse effects on the brain. She did one of the largest studies that's been done in animals to see the effect of fluoridating water on their brain function. And she used a very innovative modern technique. And in this technique, she used computers to see the behavior of the animal so that it was totally objective. There was no subjective influence by the researcher themselves. That had never been done before, and all this was high-tech equipment. She completed her study, and to her surprise, the fluoride produced two main effects. If you fed the fluoride to a pregnant animal, the offspring then became hyperactive.